So round two from grad students in my lab. This is Griffin McDaniels, and Griffin also came to me poaching from Auburn University. Actually, Craig Geyer was very kind to recommend that these guys come to JSU so we could work together. And I have been absolutely thrilled between Caitlin and Griffin to start with, and then later additions. Man, we got a great core for a good group of students. Griffin, where Caitlin tends to want to do more whole organism behavioral things, Griffin tends to want to go the other direction, and he tends to want to do more molecular-based things. And he's got an absolutely cool project that consumes my thinking and his thinking almost night and day. And so I'm just going to let him talk to you, because we can talk forever on this particular one topic. So Griffin, it's yours.
It's very true. Thank you for the introduction. So you said, my name is Griffin, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about my thesis on taking a broader approach to the ecology and timing of the symbiosis between the spotted salamander and the unicellular green algae. So I hope you guys are ready for more salamander talking pictures. So first, we've got to tell this story about the interaction that I'm studying. So the first player here is the spotted salamander, Ambystoma maculata. This female right here was actually captured on the photograph from a local pond behind Walmart, Henry Farms Park, back there, about 2 weeks ago. She was beautiful and cooperative in my photographing nonsense here. But what you guys need to know about her, they're mole salamanders, mole in quote, because they sort of tend to live under leaf litter and soil. They're fossorial diggers, and they eat invertebrates, worms, things like that. And they spend most of the year underground. They are winter breeders and migrators. So starting about beginning of winter-ish, so somewhere between November and February, they start to migrate up to a mile, actually, to a vernal wetland or a depression in the soil where they know it's going to fill up with water. After that first warm-ish winter rain, so this year it was actually 2 weeks ago, the males come out. They do their little mating ritual things, compete for the prime pond side real estate, and lay down the genetic material for spermatophores. A couple of days after that, the females come in, they meet up, and they'll deposit their eggs on some of the emergent vegetation floating around in the water column. And then finally, they are known as spotted salamanders, or spots, because they have these yellow spots. So this is a particularly old female, and so her spots are a little faded, but you can see the orange-yellow coming out at the nape of the neck there. And those are warning colorations. It's aquasymmetism to say, I taste really bad, he's dumb. The other half of this interaction here is the algae that we think is named Oophila amblystomanus. It doesn't really have a common name, and it's a putative species, which means the verdict is still out. It depends on who you ask, whether they think it's a distinct genetic lineage, whether it's just a subspecies that tends to associate with these salamanders, but it is an algae. It's within the family Chlamydomonidaceae, which is a mouthful. But it just indicates that these are these little green guys. Their primary life stage has the two little antenna on the end, and they're kind of cute looking. There's several forms throughout their life history, but you will notice that they're all intensely green, which tends to indicate that they are photosynthetic. They are photosynthesizing. They range from somewhere between 60 to 30 microns wide, so they're a little bitty, they're hard to detect. And see, the point that we're getting at here is that they invade and live within these salamander pegs. And that is the crazy cool part, because they are photosynthesizing inside those eggs, and actually inside those salamander tissues. So we classify this association as an endosymbiosis, so symbiosis pertaining to organisms living in close association, and endosymbiosis indicating within, so one organism living within the other. And it's actually intracellular, which means that the algal cells can be found within cells of the developing salamander embryo. And while in there, they are photosynthesizing. So you can check out a couple of these shots. This is what a salamander egg mass looks like. They start out kind of about baseball size, and they absorb water and turn into about the size of a Nerf football for a fairly large one. And these eggs are kind of suspended in this fairly robust, bouncy, jelly-like capsule. It's pretty, it almost feels like it would bounce if you kind of dropped it. And then over here on the left, you can see these actual individual salamander eggs that have been removed from that jelly mass that are actually about to hatch. Those are very late stage. But if you look at it in kind of the right light, I don't know if the glare is helping or not, but there is some green sheen in there from the algae inside the eggs. So the interaction, what is actually going on in there? I said that they're photosynthesizing, but why does that matter? So if you check out this diagram that I've made up, on the top there, the salamander embryo, where the orange is going to do typical animal things. It'll consume oxygen, metabolize it, releases nitrogen as waste and carbon dioxide. Typically, that's what we do, right, when we breathe. They're doing that in this little capsule. What's neat is that on the other end, the algae, the green there on the bottom, takes in those metabolite wastes, the carbon dioxide and the nitrogen, and it's going to re-release oxygen, as well as adding some glucose and some amino acid components. Kind of putative studies, early studies have indicated that that's happening inside the tissues and that some of those metabolites are being transferred to the salamander tissue, but that science is a little squirrely and it's hard to get a hard answer on that. But things are looking in the affirmative in that kind of realm of evidence. And that's just the coolest thing that I've heard in my science career so far. It really gets me excited. Photosynthetic vertebrates is cool. So our question is, how and when does the algae get there? There are two kind of big schools of thought that I'm basing my hypotheses on. So there on your left, vertical transmission is the cool answer. It's the answer that I'm hoping for. But that is when the algae is going to enter those eggs while still in the maternal reproductive tract. It's possible that these algae are a maternal gift from one generation to the other. They're actually, you know, sustained throughout life and transferred from one generation to the other. The alternative, which is still cool, is an environment addition. So horizontal transmission is where the eggs are going to be laid in the environment and then the algae are going to find their way in there from that environment, which is still incredibly cool. It happens fairly early in the process. But we don't know exactly when and we're not sure how this is happening. Because like I said, these eggs are suspended in this jelly football wrapped up in a couple different layers. We're not sure when or how it gets in there. So our goal on the right there is to establish an ecological timeline for this association and then also to determine some of these spatial heterogeneity questions. So is it the same throughout an egg mass? How about a pond or between ponds? Spotted salamanders range all the way up into Nova Scotia, Canada. And this green algae has been indicated there too. So interesting questions about is it the same algae throughout the range? So our actual hypotheses are going to be the algae is more likely to be detected in some developmental stages than others. The algae is more likely to be detected in some areas of the pond than others. And it'll be more likely to be detected in some ponds than others. So really, we're just kind of zooming out and seeing how close can we get to still detect this algae and when. So our methodology is essentially a systematic sampling. We're looking at eggs from different developmental stages, and I'll tell you how to tell those in a second. Eggs from different ponds, water samples from ponds, singular ponds throughout the breeding season, and water samples from different ponds. And we're going to use similar genetic detection mechanisms like the eDNA that Caitlin did an awesome job of describing, so I'm not going to rehash that. Essentially, what we're doing is I'm going out there and just asking, are you here yet? Are you here yet? I go out to the pond, I collect water from this pond every month from when it fills to when it empties. I'm taking eggs from various developmental stages that are very conveniently laid out and illustrated by R.G. Harrison in 1969. So these are what we refer to as the Harrison stages. And all it's doing is standardizing those developmental landmarks. It gives them a number. There's a lot of developmental jargon that goes into this. I spent a lot of time talking to Dr. Rayburn about all of this, taking photos. But what we're doing essentially, in a nutshell, is dividing this into chunks that indicate larger sections of that developmental pathway. And we're seeing, is it earlier in the stage, from stages 1 to 12, where stage 1 is a singular cell, and it's a large cell. It's really interesting when you get it under the microscope, because you can see that cell with your naked eye. It's rather large. It's pretty cool. Or do they have to wait until they start to develop the neural tubes from stages and 21 and so forth. We're sort of breaking it into smaller chunks. So lots of looking under the microscope at this stage. Geographic distribution. So when we're zooming out, we're surveying these wetlands on this map of Alabama for algal presence once. So I'm just going out there during the breeding season when my friends in these various places have called me and said, they're here. Caleb and I jump in the car and we drive. And I go collect some water and some eggs. And so some of these spots that we've been checking is Montesano up near Huntsville, Henry Farms Park near Jacksonville, which has been my home in the woods. It's right, like I said, right behind the Walmart on Pelham. Frog Pond out in White Plains, which is where the George Klein Memorial Dock is. That's where our frog ponds, programs have been. We go out to Homewood, Birmingham, which is the one that's been featured in the AL.com news article where they actually have to close down a street because the salamanders move en masse so much, so the Birmingham Audubon Society has put up roadblocks for them. And then finally, back down to home towards Auburn, so Tuskegee National Forest also has a breeding pond that I've studied before that I know they're there. So taking water samples and egg masses from these, seeing if they're there yet. Localized distributions within the ponds. Henry Farms Park, I've divided this pond sort of arbitrarily into four sections, A, B, C, and D. B being the middle, tends to be the deepest section. A and C, on either end, tend to have a lot of emergent vegetation for them to use. And D on the end there is a satellite pond that fills during wet years. And so what I'm doing is monthly, usually about the middle of the month, I just took one day ago, yesterday, 15. I just take a 500 milliliter sample from each of those sections, A, B, and C, usually ending D when it feels like showing up. And also when I'm collecting egg mass samples, I'm noting the section of the pond that those eggs are coming from. And so what I'm hoping to do is establish some kind of ecological timeline. So this is a kind of a graphical representation of what I'm hoping my data will look like. So for example, evidence supporting that horizontal transmission, so that one where the algae is finding its own way from the environment, might look something like the top here, where we detect the algae from the water samples after the salamanders have come in, they've bred, and then we'll start to see the algae inside the eggs later in their development. As opposed to evidence of vertical transmission, where we'll see algae in these eggs before we see the algae in the water. So really I'm just trying to see who shows up to the party first. And sadly, the verdict is still out. Okay, like we've alluded to before, weather has been a problem. And I would have liked to think that I would have thought that I had something more to show you guys, but due to the drought last year, the salamanders didn't breed. And this year, they decided to wait and not breed until last week, so I haven't had time to gear up that data yet. But really cool stuff is coming out. So if you want to hear the end of the story, show it to my thesis defense closer to the end of the year. So that's it. I also want to thank a bunch of people, the SOS Biology Department, my committee, Drs. Klein, Rayburn, and Murdoch, Jimmy Stiles from Auburn for giving me a heads up on where to go and check for these needs. The Alabama Herpetological Society has a large group of people that have kind of been a sounding board, and they've really been my kind of eyes in the field all over the state telling me where to go, particularly Brandon Ballard here at the bottom. My friend from Birmingham has been helping me out. My fiance, Caitlin Henderson, who has really put up with my nonsense and helped me go out to the pond at midnight to collect samples and talk to the police because they often show up wondering what I'm doing. my parents as well, and Blossom, the Herp Lab. So, Sackstar and Collins, Eric Klein, Derek Hood, Jacob Garman, and our two newest members, Sandra Elliott and Don Canterbury, who have been helping me as well as Caitlin with our research. Any questions?